The government issued its most dramatic report yet about climate change today, and it came with a dire warning. Scientists said the country is already reeling, feeling major effects of climate change, and it has already cost the United States hundreds of billions of dollars. The report, which was issued by 13 federal agencies, also highlights how climate change is expected to have a significant impact on the future of the economy. The report links climate change with extreme events like Hurricanes Maria and Harvey, and longer, more intense, more frequent Western wildfire seasons. And scientists say there's more to come. The continental United States is already 1.8 degrees warmer than it was a century ago, and the temperature may rise by another 2.3 degrees by 2050. Unless more is done, the risks and impact of climate change are expected to shrink the U.S. economy 10% by century's end. David Easterling of NOAA, which released the report, suggested in a media call that climate change would damage the country's infrastructure, economy, and human health.
The global average temperature is much higher and is rising more rapidly than anything modern civilization has experienced. And this warming trend can only be explained by human activities.
While almost no one will escape the effects of climate change, scientists say underserved and lower-income Americans, as well as coastal communities, will feel the brunt most immediately.
Future generations can expect to experience and interact with natural systems in ways that are much different than today. Without significant reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, extinctions and transformative impacts on some ecosystems cannot be avoided.
The assessment is a stark contrast with the views and policies of President Trump, who often denies or dismisses the role of climate change. Today, scientists wouldn't say whether the White House pushed to have the report released on the afternoon after Thanksgiving. With us now, Michael Oppenheimer of Princeton University. He's a professor of geosciences and international affairs at Princeton's Woodrow Wilson School. He was the lead author of separate international climate reports issued by the United Nations. Mr. Oppenheimer, thanks so much for joining us. What struck you? What is the most significant thing to you about this report?
Well, the blaring headline message is that climate change is here, it's happening, it's now. Americans are already paying for it. They're already suffering from it. It's not an abstract problem that may come on us at some time decades into the future. The second point about that is, well, you can look on your TV screen and see it almost every day. California burning up due to wildfires. Over the last couple of months, hurricanes wreaking havoc on the Gulf Coast and the Atlantic coast. Those are problems that were made worse by climate change already, and it's only going to intensify as we go into the coming decades unless we get emissions of the greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide under control. Another clear message was that the world is interconnected. If the U.S. suffers from crop yield declines due to too much warming, then people go malnourished in Africa. If an electronic component supplier in Thailand is disrupted due to flooding, then our electronics industry that has to assemble the parts into a commercial product suffers and money is lost. The third message, which is really the most important one, is that we are way behind the eight ball. We're not doing enough to cut these emissions and bring the problem under control, and we're not doing enough to build our resilience to the inevitable impacts of climate change. In other words, we're doing very little to actually adapt to the risk. This is a big problem. There's a big gap between what governments promise to do, for instance, in the Paris Agreement, and what they're actually implementing, and even what they promised to do in the Paris Agreement. Well, there's a gap between that and what the countries would have to do to really bring the problem under control. So we're way behind the eight ball on all fronts right now.
And of course, the current president has pulled out of the Paris Agreement. This is a president who has been skeptical, to say the least, about climate change. He tweeted earlier this week talking about the cold snap that a lot of the country is going through right now, saying, whatever happened to global warming? You talked about the stark language in this report. Was there in any way a message, do you think, a shot across the bow, a warning shot at skeptics of climate change?
I think the skeptics really aren't a factor anymore. The science is so compelling and the consequences have been so vivid that in a way this is liberated to allow scientists doing these kind of assessments to really say, I think, what's been on their minds for the whole time. I think the scientific community, while it's done yeoman service, has also, to a certain degree, been a little timid. And in this report, in the report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change a couple of weeks ago, you see the clear messages coming through, unvarnished, unhidden by fancy scientific language. They're calling it like it is for a change.
You talked about the promises of the Paris Accord. Some states, notably California and other states, are trying to go it alone, even though the United States, the federal government, has pulled out. They're going to try to go on their own. Is that enough for individual states to have efforts?
This report goes out of its way to note the very strong efforts that some states and cities and other localities are making, both on the emissions reduction front and in trying to adapt to the risk. But it's not enough. An uncoordinated response taking place in hundreds or even thousands of states and localities just will never get us to where we need to go. This is a problem which needs national leadership, and that's exactly what's missing in the Trump administration response, which is basically a yawn at this point. But it's also true that other countries really have to step up, do all they can on the emissions reduction front, and on the adaptation front to make their population safe. Very few countries are doing as much as needs to be done right now.
The report also seemed to take special note or special warning that the effects are uneven, that the poorer communities are going to be affected more, according to the report, and coastal communities will be adversely affected more, according to the report.
Well, for the poor, it's really a double whammy, unfortunately. First of all, they don't have the resources to build the resilience and combat the possible impacts of climate change. And secondly, a lot of the poorest communities are where the impacts of climate change, where climate change is going to really hit the worst. So they're going to get the worst effects, and they can't defend themselves against it. So, for instance, the southeastern part of the United States, where incomes lag, really, compared to the whole country, is going to suffer some of the biggest effects in terms of extreme heat and humidity, reductions in labor productivity, and consequences along the coast. Even in relatively wealthy areas of the Southeast, let's take Miami, a well-built-up area, you're seeing coastal flooding happening not just in big storms like hurricanes, but on the daily tidal cycle in many areas. So they're getting flooding in the streets all the time. This kind of flooding, called nuisance flooding, used to happen maybe 5-10 times a year. Now it's happening maybe 30 or 40 times a year. That's due to sea level rise. What causes sea level rise? Global warming.
Michael Oppenheimer of Princeton University, thank you very much.
Thank you.